Hi guys, and welcome back to Life Design Diaries. And today, now that we're back in Manchester, we're going to be talking about what it's like to be a digital nomad. Now that we're not living the digital nomad life, we can kind of like evaluate what the last year was like for us and give our thoughts on it.
Yeah, I said to you yesterday, didn't I? I had a Facebook memory that popped up of me and Ross in Australia. It was our last day, and we were flying over to New Zealand, driving across New Zealand, flying back to Sydney, flying to Singapore, and then onto Bali. And we did all of that in like 4 days or something ridiculous, didn't right. we? Do you remember we had that crazy meeting? No, it wasn't 4 days, it was longer than that. But yeah, and I sat back and had a bit of a moment to reflect on that time and the fact that we actually managed to get all of that travel correct, because we're usually rubbish at getting to places and missing flights or not booking visas and things like that.
Yeah,
as we found out on the last day of our travel when we tried to get into India and they wouldn't let us board the plane. So yeah, that's a story for another day. We should do that, a podcast on travel mishaps.
There's many.
Yeah, there are many,
but I guess that's part of it, isn't it?
Yeah,
like you got to have that approach, I think, because as being a digital nomad, if you try and plan everything too much, then you kind of lose out on the experience of the uncertainty, which is part of it.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, so where should we start? Should we give like a quick quick overview on how we even came about becoming a digital, like going to live that life?
Yeah.
So I had been self-employed for about 3 months, hadn't I? And you were thinking about doing it as well. And following our honeymoon, which was in Bali, and we stopped off in Singapore, we just kind of fell in love with that side of the world, didn't we? It was the first time we'd gone over that far. And we were wandering around Singapore, and I said to Ross, God, I can really see us living here. You know, why can't we do that? And we managed to build up a small-ish property portfolio. And we thought to ourselves, well, if we're both freelancing and we've got our rental income from, at the time it was 3 properties, wasn't it?
Yeah.
We could absolutely do this. And then just sort of very serendipitous, wasn't it? We then ended up booking flights out to Australia in the October, and then we let our house out in Manchester, and then before we knew it, we'd landed in Sydney with 2 backpacks and 2 laptops, trying to sort of work our way through it, didn't we?
Yeah, it was good.
So
good to make that decision, though.
Yeah,
it didn't actually take that long, did it? We I think we were quite good at making that decision.
Yeah, for me, it just felt like it just happened.
Yeah,
it was like a, well, I'd love to do it. Well, I'd love to do it. So why don't we just do it? Like, it was sort of nothing to lose.
Yeah.
Originally, we had literally sold everything and thought we were going to be gone for a few years, didn't we?
Yeah.
We had to come back to the UK for my best friend's wedding. 2 weddings, in fact, in the August, end of July, August, and into December. So we always knew we had sort of that 8-month grace period, but we did think we were going to fly back off somewhere else, because of course we didn't have anywhere to live. We'd let our properties out and that was that, really, wasn't it? So we originally thought we were going to do everything very slowly, like spend 3 months or so in each country, didn't we?
Yeah, that was the plan, wasn't it?
But because we...
plans change.
Because we knew that in 8 months we were going to be coming back to the UK, we thought, why don't we try as many countries as we can a month at a time? And then anyone that we fall in love with, we can obviously just go back there and stay there longer. But it didn't really... I don't know, it didn't really work out like that.
No, and actually, thinking about it, all the people that we know have done it all kind of have, I think, the same thoughts as us, retrospectively, which is that they'd rather stay in one place for longer.
Yeah.
Like, it's hard not to be in a rush.
Yeah.
But we were we were by no means like moving around like some people do. Some people literally, it's days in a country and gone.
Yeah.
Like, we were considerably slower than that. But even then, we felt like slightly rushing.
Yeah,
to countries.
We stayed in every country a month, didn't we?
Yeah.
Thailand was the only place we went back to twice, because we did Chiang Mai for a month, which is north Thailand in the hills, near beaches or anything like that. I mean, it's beautiful. It's nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
But we really wanted to, it was after we'd been to Sri Lanka, we wanted to get a bit of beach in before we were coming back. So we went to Krabi in South Thailand.
Yeah.
Which was one of our favourite places, wasn't it, actually?
Yeah, it was great.
But yeah, I mean, we, in terms of the working and travelling, we found that balance quite difficult, didn't we? I think particularly me working with people to run businesses in the UK, that was really difficult with like time differences and phone calls and things like
that's
that.
Hard.
Like with one of the companies, I was trying to find suppliers and I had a deadline to try and get some products out and I kept missing those deadlines and it was very, very, very difficult to manage that whole process. So, I mean, you see all of the like sponsored ads on Facebook, or you see all of these people that are like, do you want to earn $10,000 a week and a minute by drop shipping or product-based businesses that you don't actually have to touch? I think that you can do and have a really good work-life balance if you do something like that. But if you're trying to create a brand or something with a bit more substance, it's incredibly difficult if you can't get your hands physically on the product and that sort of thing.
Agreed. Yeah.
Or service.
You need to be, you need to be there, don't you? Mm. Like in the thick of it.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, obviously there's always exceptions to these rules, but yeah, I definitely agree with that.
Yeah.
It's hard.
Because you started out working for a company where you were like heading up the operations of a new tech startup, weren't you?
Yeah.
And that was calls, quite difficult.
Like you said about the calls and that, you know, call, it was like 9, 10 p.m. like most days having calls. So it's just like massively changes your own routine.
Yeah.
You know, if you're going to go out or something, you know, you need to be back or you need to try and find somewhere. Wi-Fi is always like inconsistent at best in Airbnbs. So.
Yeah, exactly. And cafes and stuff.
Yeah.
And it is the most infuriating thing when you can't get online, isn't it? And you've got things to do. So yeah, so from like a work-life balance, it's more, definitely more difficult because you're knackered as well, aren't you, half the time? Not only are you grappling around to try and earn your wages and grow a business, whatever that looks like for you, but then you're in completely new environments, a lot of the time foreign languages, and the term decision fatigue, I didn't know what that was until we were traveling.
Yeah.
But that whole, every single thing, where are you going to get water from? Where are you going to live? Where are you going next? What's the weather going to be like? Like those things that you totally don't even consider every single day in your normal life.
Yeah. The complete lack of routine is just so alien, isn't it? You have to think about everything.
Yeah. And sort of when you, I've certainly found like the first couple of days arriving in a new place, I felt very sort of volatile. Hostile. Because you're getting to grips with the new look of things, the new look of everything, trying to adjust.
I mean, thinking about it now, if you were to do it for the long haul and go back to places, you'd have a completely different experience. I think now if we were to continue down that path and go back to some of the places, we'd know exactly where to go.
Oh yeah,
we know exactly what we wanted. Yeah, but you just feel way more settled, wouldn't you?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, if you're traveling to places that you've never been before, which I guess is probably one of the predominant reasons why you would do it, to go and experience. Yeah, so I think work-life balance is hard. You get very, very tired very quickly. And although you're in all of these different places and you're seeing, you know, in Sri Lanka, we saw wild elephants and a monkey would run up behind you. And, you know, like you're living this dream, really, because it's so unusual and exotic and pretty. And you do have, I mean, each person will be different, but we certainly found that when we got our head in our laptops, it was really hard to get them out of your laptop. And then when you were traveling and really enjoying yourself, it was really hard to get yourself back into work mode, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So it was just quite tricky to enjoy growing business, enjoy traveling, and enjoy it all. I mean, you can, of course, and we did have a really, really ace time, but there is an edge to it, which I don't think everybody shares. with you.
Yeah,
you know,
I agree.
Some
yeah,
of
yeah.
the, like, we read a lot of Johnny FD blogs, and what's that, Matt?
Well, yeah, we've interviewed him on the podcast.
What's that?
But
oh, yeah,
that's an interesting one, because, you know, we started that podcast Living the Dream of Johnny FD, because he genuinely lives the dream. Yeah.
Yeah,
so this is our, you know, this is our thoughts and experience on life as a digital nomad. He is the opposite. He would never consider going home, you know.
Yeah.
He's been doing
it
now for like 10 years. He absolutely loves it.
Yeah.
And he is doing drop shipping and investing and stuff like that. So
yeah, hands off sort of thing.
I think, yeah, the passive stuff, you know, that's the, I guess the dream is the passive kind of lifestyle, isn't it?
Well, is it though? It's not for everybody, is it?
Yeah, exactly. The soul dream. I mean, I read a really interesting blog with a completely different analysis on Tim Ferriss's 4-hour work week, because most people that like I would actually say 99% of people that were living the digital nomad life have read that book and been inspired by that book. And this blog was like, the 4-hour work week is ripping people off. It's making people think that there's this life when they can go and, you know, sip on cocktails and sort of work from their sun lounges. And it kind of like analyzed everything and was like, my experience, it was like this. My experience was nowhere like that. And I thought that was quite interesting. I'm kind of in between, because there are people that have done it, and we've spoke to people that do absolutely love that lifestyle. We really enjoyed that lifestyle, but it just comes down to like what you want as your end game, I think.
Yeah, I think we did enjoy, I think because we traveled once a month and everything was so new and we were meeting new people every month, that was really interesting to keep it sort of fresh for us. But we did only meet one couple, didn't we, in that 8 months that we really clicked with. That was in Chiang Mai. And we still are in contact with them now, and they're lovely. They live in Australia now. But apart from that, we did get a little bit lonely, didn't we, in some sometimes. Yeah.
Is that because traveling as a couple, though?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Well, the reason why I was going to say that is I think it all comes down to circumstance, how you experience the travel. We were doing it together. So on the one hand, we weren't ever lonely because we had each other, but then we only had each other.
Yeah.
And then we
Tell
were,
me about it.
and then we were trying to, we weren't building hands-off products. We, you know, the hands-off businesses where you're just flogging products, basically. Mm. We were building something that was more of substance, and I've said that twice.
Yeah.
And then obviously we were moving quicker than a lot of people generally do, because we had the 8 months where we had to go home. So it just made sense for us to do that. But I think if you can like unpick those pockets of things you should take into consideration, you can have a very good time with it or quite a bad time with it, I think.
Yeah.
I think in terms of cash flow and that sort of thing, we did go with a buffer of some savings, didn't we? But we didn't really dip into them until the end when
you don't spend that much.
No, exactly.
That's one of the massive drivers, isn't it? Is that the cost of living is so little.
Yeah.
And especially if you do it slow, because the biggest cost is probably flights.
Mm.
So if you are literally trying to tick off countries and go all around the place, then you're going to spend loads more. If you want to go and stay, in like Thailand, and you actually want to do like 3 or 6 months,
yeah,
and you get
can
a place
rent,
out there, it is like
rent
ridiculous.
Little condos, can't you?
Yeah, it's like 200
and
quid a month.
Obviously, both Ross and I are an older traveler, so we weren't getting in the back of buses or on sleeper trains and things like that, were we?
No,
we were flying places, and
we stayed in nice places,
and
nice
we did stay in a hostel a couple of times, didn't we?
But yeah, and that's where we met the most people, though.
Yeah,
isn't it?
That's true. Yeah, so, well, actually, not really, we didn't meet anybody in Chiang Mai, did we? In Sri Lanka. Yeah, we did.
We slept the same room as people.
Yeah, but no one bloody talked to you in that hostel, did they? I mean, it was a very nice one. They had double beds with they were like little capsules, weren't they? And we intentionally stayed in that hostel for a week, didn't we? Because we wanted to make friends.
Yeah, we wanted to experience what it was like in a hostel.
Yeah.
It's definitely
the one and only time.
Very different. I think traveling as a couple, if you're single, you know, hugely.
Yeah, I mean, you don't get jiggy
if you're single, you'd just be out all the time.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so I think from a cash point of view, I think it's really great if you are sensible and you do have a little buffer just in case things happen. You know, we had an accident and we ended up in the hospital. If we didn't have insurance, that could have cost us money that we didn't budget, and things do happen. So for example, we booked cheap flights back from New Delhi to the UK really, really early on in our trip, didn't we? Because they were an absolute steal and we wanted to go to India.
Yeah.
So it ended up that we were in Bangkok for a couple of weeks, and then we were going to do a couple of days in New Delhi off of the back of people saying to us, stay in New Delhi for as little as possible, get in and get out. So we'd literally planned less than 48 hours, wasn't it? We were going to land, go and see the Taj Mahal, do all of that. Because it was the last stop before we were going back home for a stint of time, we'd booked a really nice hotel because they're absolutely, like, really, really cheap in New Delhi, but they're gorgeous hotels, like the Four Seasons and stuff.
Yeah.
So we booked all of that. We were so excited. Went to bed for a few hours, got up at about 3 o'clock, went to the airport in the queue to fly to New Delhi. We checked in and everything, went to drop our bags off, and the lady said, where's your visa? And we were like, oh no, we're flying out in a couple of days, because that's normally what happens. You can get a couple of day visa entry. As long as you've got your flight in and out, then yeah, it's fine. They were like, no, you can't get into the country without the visa. And we were literally stood there like, well, no, you have to let us in. Like, we were feeling very righteous and entitled. I said, well, can we apply for one now? No, even the fast ones will take 48 hours or something. So we ended up just throwing away money for the flight, throwing away money for the hotel. And then we, in the airport, can you believe being in an airport trying to book flights is the most difficult thing ever? There's no one there to help you or anything, was there?
Yeah, there's like no desk. Well,
no desk to go online and just book a flight. So we ended up then getting a 6 a.m. flight straight back to the UK, wasn't it? We were home about...
Ended it early.
It wasn't long, was it? A couple of days early. But, you know, that it's those things that you... silly mistakes.
Yeah, I mean,
really,
the advice there definitely with visas is don't assume. It's like check every single place you're going, like, what, because there was another one where we had it on our phone,
Vietnam,
and we needed to print it off, and then we needed
pictures,
to take $50 or something,
pictures, little passport pictures of yourself.
Yeah,
those,
so there's
things,
all those, like, definitely that piece of advice there is with visas,
yeah,
like, don't just assume. And it's hard because after you've been to like 10-15 countries, you think it's
they've
okay,
all got the same process, yeah, in place, don't you? Yeah, definitely. So yeah, I think there's always, make allowances for unexpected accidents, or like in Bali, we stayed a day over, didn't we, the visa date by mistake, didn't even realize.
Yeah, of course.
And they charged us 50 quid each or something, didn't they?
Yeah.
That's the other place we met some people. There was a whole group of stupid English travellers sat in the back of Bali's airport whilst we were all told off and had bad stamps put in our passports. But yeah, funny. But where was the best place that you went?
You didn't even mean to do that, did you?
I didn't mean to do that. If you want to know why that's funny, go back to the previous podcast. But anyway, let's talk about the good places that we went to. Talk about that. Because I think that is always an interesting one.
So our favourite place was Bali, yeah?
Yeah, on par with New Zealand. I've always got a caveat with that because I can't choose.
So if you're going to go to Bali and go... I would definitely say go to Bali if you're doing Asia, because it's, again, you get the benefits of it being so cheap and mm-hmm. it's great. Whereas New Zealand is costly, isn't it?
Why is Bali great?
Just the culture was great. The food was great. Like, living there was awesome. Like, you could really embed yourself in a brand new culture.
Mm,
the weather was awesome when we went. When did we go?
Yeah, the people were amazing, weren't they? Yeah, when did we go? April time, wasn't it?
Yeah.
April to May, I think. Yeah, we just absolutely fell in love with the people. The Balinese people are the most genuinely kind, open, loving.
Yeah, they are.
But they're loving, this is going to sound ridiculous, not only to people, but to things, to animals, to nature. I do know that they've got quite a big plastic problem, but they've got a bit of an education problem, so that's why that is. you know, that we stayed. If anybody is going to Bali and wants a recommendation of somewhere to stay, please email us, because we have got the most fantastic host and two-bed house in his little complex in Ubud, which is sort of the center of the island. Yeah, we just had a really wonderful experience there, didn't we? It's close to our hearts because that's where we went on our honeymoon.
But yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's really, really wonderful. It's probably one of the, I guess, aside from Thailand, like the best place we went for food, service.
Yeah.
Experiencing sort of such a variety.
And it's also got like pool parties, like you can, like,
yeah, you can get into some Western culture as well. You can do both there, can't you? You can really see the traditional stuff, and you can go and still not feel like you're in the middle of on the moon or something like that, which is how we felt when we were in Vietnam a bit, wasn't it? So yeah, absolutely loved Bali. We stayed in Ubud for the whole month because we'd done the coast when we were, I say we'd done, we've been to some of the places on the coast for our honeymoon. But yeah, we loved it. And then New Zealand just absolutely took my breath away in terms of the nature and the surroundings and the lakes and the mountains. And again, the people were really, really lovely. I just think you could go and have a really clean life there.
Yeah.
That the air tasted sweet, you know, it was just outrageously beautiful. Really similar, I think, to Scotland, that sort of like Scotland on I don't know, drugs.
Steroids?
Is that what you're trying to say? On acid. So absolutely loved. In fact, we went in and spoke to an estate agent, didn't we? And New Zealand, but it was so expensive.
Yeah, we were a bit tempted. And the worst, so that's our best two, it's the worst two.
Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
So we had a really bad time. Well, the beginning of our time in Sri Lanka was bad. The end was good because one of our best mates came out to stay with us. So we had a good time. But in terms of the country itself, for me, it was probably the wildest place we went, in terms of it's really up and coming in tourism. We didn't see any women around. And because of the time of year that we went, we did northeast. And normally you do southwest. That's where all of the hotels are and the complexes and things like that.
Yeah.
So where we went to was very out of the way. I just felt it my most unsafe. Like we had a few incidences where, like, this guy, I mean, it's not funny at all, mixed up some chemicals incorrectly in our hotel and created like an explosion, and he was taken to hospital on the back of a tuk-tuk. And like, and then another incident where we were sat having some breakfast on the beach and someone was drowning and then they had to be resuscitated and stuff. And I've never seen so many bad accidents happen.
Yeah,
you know, and it happens, but because they obviously haven't got the infrastructure and stuff there in place like here, it was just one of those places where you thought, shit, if something goes wrong here, something's going to go wrong, you know?
Yeah.
So, but then in the same breath, it was beautiful. Like the beaches untouched, the jungle stunning, the train drive from Ella to Kandy, beautiful. Bumpy, if you get car sick, take some tablets. Yeah, it was throwing us around loads and loads.
I don't think it would get you sick
though. Oh my god, it was like being on a roller coaster at the start. Don't you remember? Yeah, crazy. And also cover yourself up. Like there was a few incidences where like men like to touch you and things like that, which probably wasn't the best. But yeah, so and we were coming to the end of our journey. We were knackered financially. Things were not as happy as they were when we first started because of like properties that we were buying at the time. And yeah, just things sort of went a little bit haywire, didn't it? Sri Lanka wasn't what we expected it to be, because I think we'd read and done loads of research about the southwest, which would have been a more comfortable stay, being so knackered. I mean, like, woe is me, for God's sake. But anyway, So yeah, it was probably just the most difficult in terms of working, living, and yeah, just felt very misunderstood in that country, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
What about you?
No, I agree, 100%.
Where else would you say was the most difficult?
Probably Vietnam, although loads of people love Vietnam, so it's like mixed messages. I think we probably stayed in the wrong place for a bit too long.
We love Saigon, didn't we? Like, that was really cool.
I think this is one piece of advice or one thing that we learned is that it's probably best to like get somewhere. And if you want to book ahead, because we did want to book ahead. Some people say literally get there, stay one night and then find out. But we wanted to like know we were in somewhere for like a week. But I would do that as a max. I would book a week and then during that week, find out if you want to stay there or you want to then get somewhat longer. Whereas we booked a month.
We went before we got there.
So straight away we're there. And if the place is great, then amazing. But in Vietnam, the hotel was great, but the place, where was it? Hoi An,
yeah.
Which people love and it's a beautiful, it is nice. Like, I wouldn't say it's incredible, but it is quite a nice, you know, walk around in the lanterns and stuff. But staying there for a month is quite boring.
Yeah, like, people tend to stay there for a couple of days.
Yeah.
Where were we before that? I can't remember. Chiang Mai?
Yeah.
Or Bali? So. No, it was Bali because I went and my foot was bad.
Right. Yeah.
So we'd been in Bali and we kind of just wanted a bit of chill, didn't we? So we thought, oh, let's stay in somewhere chill in Vietnam. Like we didn't really want to go to the big cities, did we?
No.
My sort of advice on top of what you just said is take people's recommendations with a pinch of salt.
Right.
So I know that we're sat here saying, oh, we think this, we think that, but make your own mind up because whereas we fell head over heels in love with Bali, people were saying to us, nah, I don't like it. And people would say they absolutely love Vietnam.
But so true.
We lost loads of weight. we weren't eating very well, were we? We just found it quite hard work, I think. But we stayed in a gorgeous homestay called Banana Gardens, which was brand new and stuff.
Yeah, that
and
was
it was
cool.
Wonderful. The people were so nice, weren't they?
It's like being in a nice hotel.
Yeah, little hotel was cute. Very, very cheap. Remarkably cheap.
So what about Wi-Fi then as we're traveling? Do you find that hard or fine? A lot of people complain about
it. The majority of the time it was fine, wasn't it?
I think it was fine.
Yeah.
I think it's like you obviously need to connect and stuff when you get to places, but I don't think there's much problems. Even in cafes, really. It was okay.
Yeah.
Like everywhere, pretty much.
I mean, the amount of places that are popping up to cater for the worker on the go. And like everywhere we went, we tended to choose somewhere which had a bit of a digital nomad community, didn't we, really? In Bali in particular and Chiang Mai, they are two massive hubs. Chiang Mai in Thailand, massive hubs for digital nomads, weren't they? So there's loads of co-working spaces and things like that. Not that we invested in going to them, did we?
No.
Which in hindsight, maybe we could have spent a day or so, because the one event that we did go to, because I spoke, didn't I?
Yeah.
That's where we met a load of people and ended up going on a really good night out.
In the day, you've got to put yourself out there.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's all too easy just to sit and not bother, put the effort in. Mm. Yeah. So
what would you say to someone then thinking about doing it?
To do it. I'm really, really, really pro getting out there because I feel like I've come back much more happier in myself.
I think I
learned some stuff that we sort of went not really expecting to. We went thinking we knew everything about everything, but I think that we did learn certain things about ourselves, like in terms of how we want to carry on living our life and things that I think we picked up some real gems from people along the way, like our host in Bali. He was just the most wonderful bloke. And we often say to each other in times of need, what would Dewa do? Because, you know, he had such a spiritual, wonderful outlook on things. So I think, my advice is to do it, prepare yourself and, just do it. What would you say?
I would say that as well, At the end of the day, if you're trying to like weigh it up now and thinking, do I want to do it or not, you're always going to learn something.
Yeah.
Which is great.
What's the worst that can happen kind of thing?
Yeah, you're going to come back with like so much experience.
Mm.
You know, you've seen loads more stuff. You've tried different things. I think if your main passion is to grow a huge business, then it's probably going to stand in your way. But yeah. equally, it might be a good way just to experience it. You can always come back anyway. So yeah, I would say do it. I think it's an important thing to do, which yeah. I never thought before. But I actually think, yeah, if someone's thinking about doing it, then clearly, especially if that like grows, that thought. For us, it wasn't like a long thought. We haven't been dreaming about it for years, had we?
Mm.
But I know some people have, like they literally do think about it for years and years. It's like this ongoing thing.
Yeah, if you've got the opportunity to do it, just do it, definitely.
Because you need, a few £1,000 each month or less. Some people, if they're really, really going, like, can probably get away with like £1,000 a month.
Yeah, a couple of £100 a month even, if you're staying in hostels and things like that.
Well, yeah.
Just, yeah.
I'd say you want at least £1,000 a month. We were like a few thousand probably.
Yeah.
So it's really not much.
Yeah, it's nothing. And I think that, you know, those sorts of lessons that we learn, we're still trying to adhere to that here, aren't we? Living a bit more minimally.
Yeah, because I think the space that it gives you is an amazing chance to reflect on sort of what you want and what you're doing and all those kind of like deep and meaningful thoughts.
Yeah. So why would you say we didn't go back out then? Why have we stayed back? Why are we living back in our house and we've been back 6 months, which feels like 6 minutes, but
it does, doesn't it? It flies. Well, it's like you said, we want to kind of get stuck in now into our careers. I think that coupled with actually, although the kind of fantasy of not having a routine and not having to set your alarm and living the free life sounds great in as it plays out, like we said, there's a lot of stress and mental overhead that comes with that. So I'm like, we're both really enjoying the routine that we have now, like getting back into normal life and having some boundaries around it. Seeing friends and family,
that also gives you less headspace, giving yourself so much freedom, I think. Do you know what I mean? Because we talked earlier about that mental fatigue. Actually, when you're trying to focus on what, you know, your work or something, if you don't have any structure in your life, you know, where you're living, what you're doing, where you get a glass of water from, it is really, really difficult to then settle yourself and focus, isn't it?
Yeah. Really, so I think that's why. So yeah, it's a good question, because people probably listen to this if we're saying go and do it, and yet we're not doing it anymore. But that is it. It's like the experience is great. I think it has a shelf life. I do think it has a shelf life. There are some people that have been doing it, like we said about Johnny FD, for like 10 plus years. And we interviewed Danny Flood as well earlier on the podcast. Again, he's been doing it for ages. I personally think you're bound to have a shelf life. You know, even if it's 10 plus years, at some point, you're going to want to stick some roots down somewhere. Because I just think that is like conforming to conventional living. But I think that culture, which is in place, that you kind of stick around in one place and then, you know, embed yourself and have loads of friends. I think that's the way it is for a reason, really, because that is like healthy.
Mm.
I think so. Otherwise, I think you could be quite isolated, even if you meet loads of friends and stuff and you can keep moving. I just feel like you personally could be isolated.
So, yeah, definitely. I agree. Yeah.
So the advice would be do it, but we're back because we want to like get stuck in now, career-wise and friend-wise, and take everything that we learn and keep it.
Apply it to yourself. Yeah. In whatever way it sort of fits into your situation, I suppose.